Thanks to the chairman and Mr. Raju for their kind words. But one thing I'm sure all of you would have noticed, both from Mr. Raju and Mr. KC. Raju said there are so many sections, so many rules, so many forms. Mr. Ravi will deal at length. KC said there are so many sections. In fact, virtually he narrated all the sections, all the forms, saying there are the highlights. Ravi will deal them all elaborately. Finally, both of them concluded within next 20 minutes. This is where we are pushed in the New Companies Act also. If you look into the New Companies Act, the disclosure norms prescribed and the same type of disclosure that are required to be published in more than one document by way of imposition, repetition of the same information. And ultimately, if in one place if you miss out, the amount of penalties are so very heavy, one will not be surprised if three violations, you will become insolvent, you can never become either a director or an auditor anywhere. So a sort of threatening legislation, though both of them have also made a common remark, let us all welcome this Companies Act 2013. Probably after hearing me, we will take a decision whether we have to welcome or not. At the outset, I congratulate the organizers for a very well-structured program, because the motto of this new law is accountability. Therefore, they started with accounts. Then they say raise money, whether for the betterment of the company or for the stakeholders or for the promoters to run away. And then the brain will take the decision in the afternoon after lunch. After hearing all these things, if you are still interested, you all will know how to form a company from Dhanapal. So well structured. With this prelude, let me get on to the subject that has been slated for me. I'll try my level best to hurry up and try to highlight only those points which I thought that every one of us should gear up to meet the challenges. It starts from section 43, it goes up to section 72. As far as the share capital chapters are concerned, including debentures. Fundamental, the same kinds of share capital, the share of two kinds, equity with the voting rights, equity with the differential rights, and we have the preference shares. Now, what is great in this? Equity share capital with voting rights, all of us are aware of it. Equity share capital with the differential rights as to dividend, voting, or otherwise. What is this otherwise means? We all know a share has two rights. A return that I require, the right that I can voice in the shareholders meeting saying, look, I am a part owner of this company, I have something to say. What this word otherwise connotes is a big question mark, but still, probably something else may crept out of this share, so they have kept it open for the word otherwise. And I've used the word SEDR throughout my presentation for the sake of convenience, which means share capital and debenture rules 2014. Which is coming to force from 1st April 2014. So this is only one point in this particular thing that you must keep in mind. Next, please. Now the preference share capital, the age-old definition right from plus two level, the same question they ask. When a capital is called as a preference capital, it comprises of the two rights, preferential right to dividend, preference right for the repayment of capital. Over and above that, of course, at the time of redemption, you may make a premium. Yes, choice is yours. Then we go on to say, are they eligible to have a right to participate on the surplus available after sharing with the equity? Next. And in respect of that, if you have an additional right, we call them as a participating preference shares. So there is no change in that, so I'm not going to deliberate more on that. So fundamentally, the position as it exists earlier, vis-a-vis as it exists today, there is only one minor change for which there is no answer what the word otherwise means. The major change which is hidden or smuggled is the provision that exists in the current act which deals with the kinds of share capital. There is a general section which says that section is not applicable to a private company. As a result of it, the various nuances involved in the differential voting rights rules that was there under the earlier law, now under the new avatar of the 2013 act also we have a differential voting right rules under the share capital and debenture rules. That will apply to a private company also. And as a result, if you look into those rules, you will be surprised to note a company which is just starting, and especially a JV company where we used to have the rhythm of the Indian promoter will having certain rights, the foreign promoter will have certain rights, and the voting, not only the voting, but also the different in the sharing of the profit, a company will not be in a position to do, because there should be a track record of 3 years. So till 3 years, the SPV, what we are calling it as, will find it difficult to incorporate this particular provision which they have agreed upon in the JV agreement or in the share subscription agreement or whatever you call it as. Next. Now, as a teacher, I have put down the entire section in the form of question answer for twin benefits. One, for the purpose of sharing with all of you, over a period of time, I will convert them into a part of book. Right? That's how I do. So, the same logic I am following now also. Can a company issue shares with differential rights to dividend voting otherwise? There are three categories of companies. No private company, unlisted public company, or listed company shall issue unlisted companies. That's a negative connotation. That means these three categories of companies will be able to issue differential voting rights shares only when they comply with the conditions stipulated. Next, please. The conditions are too many. So, I'll just narrated the power in the articles, shareholders' consent, quantum of shares, there is a restriction, consistent track record of distributable profit for the last 3 years. Then only you are an eligible bachelor to come out with such an issue. Next. This one unique situation you can see throughout the legislation, more particularly with reference to share capital. The legislators have given weightage or importance to, you must ensure that you don't default to the public deposits. You must ensure that already committed redemption, either on preference or on debentures, are duly met. You must ensure the company has not defrauded the employees for non-payment of ESI, PF, or whatever dues. This has been repeatedly emphasized in all the places. So whenever you comply with this, then only you are eligible to do that particular issue. So you can see this but in almost everywhere. They are not defaulted in filing the statements, payment of dividend, repayment of term loan, payment of dues with reference to statutory payments, relating to employees, to any authority, and crediting the amount in investor education and protection fund to the CG. Next. There should be no subsisting default. That is, already if there is a commitment and you have not paid, then it still continues. There is payment of declared dividend or repayment of matured deposits, redemption of preference. And the company has not been penalized. You can see so many laws are given. Not only now, for the last 3 years. So, RBI Act, SEBI Act, SERA, FIMA, or any other special act that is applicable to that particular company based on the sectoral regulations. So, depending upon you are an insurance company or you are a telecom company or a, what you call as any other infrastructure company where you have a separate sectoral laws that are applicable to you, you must ensure that you are not defaulted in that, not only now, but also during the last 3 years. That means, in short, unless otherwise you are a good boy for the last 3 years, with a healthy financial background, you cannot think of issuing shares with a differential voting rights. That is the moral of the story. Then, details of the matter to be disclosed. This is the disclosure requirement. This, you will be surprised. First, you will tell the shareholder, look, at the time you give the consent, beware, these are all the things. Then, after everything is over, at the end of it, when you are giving the financial statement, again, the directors will disclose in the director's report, beware, these are all has already been done. So, the same disclosure invariably, probably here and there some minor changes, again gets repeated. The rule interlay mandates that the shareholders approval in GM by ordinary resolution should contain the following details. What are they? Next. Percentage of shares, reasons for the justification for the issue, price, basis on which the price has been arrived at, in the case of private placement or preferential basis, so many details are there. In the case of public issue, again, so many details. So, each one I can explain, but as I told you, within 20-25 minutes I have to cover, so it is not possible because this still has 117 slides I have. Next. Sale, scale or proportion, change in control, diluted earnings, pre and post issue shareholding, in fact there is a format itself is given. Can a company after the commencement convert the existing equity capital into equity capital differential voting rights? Law is very clear, you cannot. So, already you have issued a share capital with equity share capital, can I convert the differential right? No. So, categorical, a company shall not convert its existing equity capital with voting rights into equity share capital carrying differential voting rights or vice versa. So, either way, it is not permitted. As you were, you will continue. As you want, you can start. As simple as that. Next. Disclosure to be made in the director's report. Now, you did it in the explanatory statement. Now, again, this explanatory statement, we used to have the privilege in the earlier legislation 170 used to say, unless the articles otherwise provide, the provisions of section 171 to 186 will apply. Now that relaxation is not there. So the new law says, explanatory statement is mandatory, whether you are a public company or a private company. So similarly, in the director's report, you are going to give a huge amount of disclosures. Next, please. You will be seeing that almost everything that is given in the explanatory statement will find a place here. Next. I am reminded of, we used to write in the exam, then we used to get the guideline answer also. Same thing, first at the time of sanctioning, that is writing the exam, after passing the exam, guideline answer to verify. Same logic applies here, the director's report which succeeds, you will be giving the same rights. Now state the rights of the holder of the equity share, the differential rights, vis-a-vis bonus shares and right shares, am I eligible for it? The law is very clear from the rules, it provides all rights such as bonus rights, etc. will be given to you, but the holder of the equity share, the differential rights, shall also enjoy subject to the differential voting rights. That means it presupposes at the time when you make a bonus issue or a rights issue also, you are bound to classify them under two different heads. And if I am going to give it a normal equity shareholder, the normal bonus share, a differential voting shareholder, the differential right attached to that. Disclosure made in the register of members, the register of member is a register required to maintain under section 88, coming under chapter 7 if my memory serves right. So in that, you are supposed to make an entry about the shares, whether it is a normal share or it is a differential voting right share. What is the state of the share issued under the 56 Act with the differential rights? What is the differential that is given? It appears from the reading of the explanation, the rights with these shares were issued under 56 can be varied under the 2039. Whereas in the earlier provision, there is a categorical mention, you shall not. But I request you all to, previous one dear, I request you all to go and read the explanation given to rule 4. You'll be surprised, it appears it can be varied. Whereas when you see the earlier one, can I convert the existing equity share capital? The law is very clear, you cannot. Let us go into the details, then you will understand it. Next, please. Nature of shares, there is no change, shall be movable property transferred in the manner that is erstwhile section 82 is reproduced. Numbering of shares, there is no difference, nothing in the section applied for the shares held in depository, the same provision continues. The number, the dates that is given in the bracket is the date on which the section has come into force. For the sake of convenience, I have given. The shares or other debentures or interest in a member of company shall be movable property transferable. Yes, next one, sorry. Certificate of shares. Prima facie evidence, as probably when Mr. Dhanakopal is going to explain about the certificate of incorporation, we are missing some very crucial term, but at least here they are still maintained prima facie evidence. Right? So prima facie evidence that is mentioned. Now, before going into all the other two, three slides that is going to follow this, concept is very simple. The moment you invest, the moment you are allotted shares, I should get evidence. That evidence is in the form of piece of paper. What is the value of it, worth of it, subsequent performance of the company. That piece of paper will be issued in accordance with certain procedure. It will be signed in accordance with the procedure given. Now in the rule itself it says a format of the share certificate has been given. In the format of the share certificate, again disclosure requirements are more, because you are not only supposed to write the name of the company, the address, but also the SIN number, etc. In fact, I was jokingly telling one of my clients, leave the first page for disclosure of your company, start the communication on the second page. Because your name, address, SIN number, tax number, VAT number, everything is going to be there. We do not know subsequently what is going to happen. In fact, in the one more seminar where Mr. Vaitishwaran was addressing, he said, even when drafting the agreement, all these years we used to say, Mr. So-and-so, son of so-and-so. Hereinafter, we will say, Mr. So-and-so, SIN of so-and-so. Because SIN number is going to become such a compulsory one. That is a sin we have committed, we have to comply with it, there is no choice. And suppose the certificate becomes destroyed, the certificate becomes spoiled, you have to issue a new share certificate, can I? Yes, that is what we call them as a duplicate share certificate. And for the duplicate share certificate, there is a procedure, similarly for a consolidation, and the shares are being issued not only when transfer takes place, but also when transmission takes place, or when the slots given at the back gets exhausted. There are so many reasons, or a merger and amalgamation, you get exchange of shares. So many reasons why you get a new certificate from the company. For all these things, the slide rules covers. It only says, whatever you do, you do, you are permitted. But the only thing is, make an endorsement of the register of members according to that. This certificate is issued, wide number so-and-so, arising out of the destruction of the old certificate, or because the slots have been exhausted, or arising out of merger amalgamation. Like that, let it be very clear on the face of it, as well as in the register of members, why the new certificate has taken that particular place in the place of or in lieu of the old certificate. Now with this background you read it, you will be able to understand. Can you issue duplicate? Yes. When? Lost or destroyed, defaced, mutilated, torn. Next. With the intent to, if you suppose you are intending issue the duplicate with the intention to fraud, punishment is there. Every officer who is punishable. Next. No certificate or shares can be held in the Cayman except in person of the resolution passed by the board on surrender of the letter of allotment, either of the two. Next. Form and contents, the law itself provides what should be the certificate format. Who will sign it? The law again provides. Next. Two directors duly authorized by the board for the purpose of the committee of the board, if so authorized, and if the composite of the board permits, at least one of the four or two directors shall be a person other than MD or whole-time director, secretary or any other person authorized by the board for the purpose. Normally, this is what is given in the earlier issue of share certificate rules. The share certificate shall be issued under the common seal of the company to be affixed in the presence of at least two directors, one of whom shall be a managing director and an authorized signatory who will sign the same in token thereof. Standard resolution we pass, that is what is being substituted here. Next. OPC, who will die? I am the one man, I myself will sign and put it in my cupboard, as simple as that. Right? Because I am the boss, I am the servant. When there is a profit, I smile, when there is a loss, I cry. As simple as that.